Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Paul Ogando.
I want to get down on my knees is what we do here. We want to honor the Word of God. So if you stand, you'll be sitting for a while there. So go ahead and stand if you're able to. Let's pray. Father God, we ask that you would lead us and guide us tonight. That you would speak to us, Lord God. We open our hearts to hear from your Word. Holy Spirit, you're the teacher of the church. Teach us tonight. Guide us, Father. Reveal to our hearts those things that are important for us to get tonight. Your word never goes back void, Father. So we believe is going to do its work in us tonight. It's going to bear great, great fruit in our own lives, Lord. And just as you're blessing us in this church, we also ask that you would bless the other churches that are in the Inland Empire and around the world. Father, we're not better than them. We're co-laborers together with them, Lord God. So if they're teaching the true gospel, we ask that you bless them tonight, that you advance them, that you continue to, that they can advance the kingdom of God alongside of us, Father God, as your word says, we're co-labor together with them. So we thank you tonight for that. In Jesus' name, we all say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Go to the book of Judges. Book of Judges. And, you know, it's a very famous story we're going to look at tonight, but I'll be honest with you, as a preacher and as a teacher of the word, a lot of times we look at something and we want to ask the Lord, Lord, would you teach me a different way to understand it? Because when you know something, has anybody ever told you a story you kind of already know, and before they tell you in your mind, you're already there? And so a lot of times when we're studying the Word of God, especially for us, we read a lot about the Word of God. So when God reveals the message to us, it's really hard for us to kind of hold back, hold the reins from arriving to a conclusion before God tells us. Just 4th of July, I was with some of our friends from our Spanish ministry, and we were, you know, hanging out the rest of the day, so we went out to see the fireworks, my family and I, but I was exhausted. I didn't want to look at no fireworks. I didn't want to hear or see fireworks, but, you know, I went with the family, and eventually we got to this spot that was kind of, you know, around our house that was okay, but the kids kept on going further to a better spot. But I stayed in the back, and I'm just kind of there looking, and then, you know, it's kind of, they pop, and you can see it from far away, and it was really beautiful. It was really nice, and, you know, but I put no effort into getting kind of acquainted with the fireworks and really getting into it and getting a good view, because if you have a good view, you kind of like everything, you love it. The point is, the thing is going, and the grand finale was amazing, and I could see some lights here and there, and it ended, and I was left kind of like, ugh. You know what I'm saying? Because I wasn't there. I didn't enjoy the whole thing. I wasn't paying attention. And a lot of people in their lives are the same way as I did in 4th of July. You have something within sight that could be so exciting for your life, that could be so transforming in your life, but you choose to stay in the wrong spot to look at it. And see, we have to find a way to regain our vision and our focus as to what God wants for our lives. Now you see it, and now you don't. And a lot of times, life is like that. You see something, but then you don't. You want to enjoy something, but then it's not available to you for whatever reason. And so I want to look at the life of Samson. How do I stay focused? How do I continue to get the vision that God put in my heart? I know for a fact that everybody here has a purpose and a vision in their own heart. You dream about it. You talk about it. You tell your cousin about it. Someday I'm going to do X, Y, and Z. Oh, 6 months ago I was in this place, but I'm not there right now. Or things change, the economy change, your life change, health issues. And so we've lost kind of the perspective as to what am I supposed to do? And I believe the story of Samson is a great story for us to recapture and refocus our vision in life. And I believe God wants to encourage you that way. See, if we walk in life without a focus as to where we're going, what we want to do, life is just going to happen to us. Does that make sense to you? Are you just going to get up and you're just going to go to work and things are just going to happen to you? But there is a purpose for it. You have to have a vision for it. I was laughing at a story I heard because I was watching the news, and some of you guys probably heard this, but a semi crashed into a bridge, an overpass in the 215, and they shut it down, a big mess. And remind me of the story of a man who was driving a semi truck. And so this man is driving the semi truck, and he hits an overpass bridge, and he gets stuck under it. So they call the police. The police shows up and says, "Man, huh? You got stuck over here." man, that's pretty bad for you. He said, no, I'm not stuck. I was delivering the bridge and ran out of gas. What do you think, man? And so many times there's two people looking at the same situation, and it just, you kind of throw yourself out there. But God wants us to focus and say, this is what it is, and I want you to work on it. And it's going to be three simple things that God gave me out of the story of Samson. Let me bring you into what we're going to be. We're going to be in Judges chapter 16, but before we get there, the story of the life of Samson is very interesting. It's one of the most popular stories in the Bible. You know who Samson is, the huge burly guy that the Spirit of God fell upon him, had long hair, and so he could destroy everything. You read his story, I mean, this guy did amazing things. If you've ever seen the competition of the world's strongest man on ESPN, I mean, these guys have nothing on Samson when the Spirit of God was upon him. So he is unbelievably strong. That's part of his calling, but it was so interesting because he's one of the judges of Israel. Before they had kings, before they had David and all these guys, Samson was one of them, just like Gideon was. They were judges. They were to lead the people of Israel into the good land and maintain them there. And it's so interesting because the Bible says that every time there wasn't a judge, the people went back to doing what was evil. You read every chapter in the book of Judges, it says, when there was no judge, when there was no direction, the people went back. You know what that is? Loss of vision. Loss of vision. You are doing something, and then all of a sudden there's no focus, there's nobody's pushing you, nobody's directing you, and all of a sudden you go back to the same routine that you had before, away from what was blessing you, away from what's directing you, away from what God wants to do in your life. And God does not want that for you. And Samson was supposed to do that, and he did for quite a while. But he was a man that was very interesting because he had a calling in his life from birth. He was to be what they call a Nazarite, somebody who wouldn't shave his hair. That's why a lot of times in the movies they paint or they depict Jesus with long hair. He was a Nazarene. That's a different thing. But a lot of people mix it up. In Nazarite, they had long hair and there were some vows of holiness. They weren't supposed to drink alcohol, do certain things to set themselves apart from apart for God and from everybody else to do the things of God. Now his job, listen to this, his calling was really to destroy the Philistine. That was his calling. That's what God brought him on earth. That's what God put on him. But Samson was a man of contrast. Listen to this. He was such a man of contrast because he did so many things. He was completely different on the inside. We sang that song. Then he was on the outside. On the outside, he was strong. He was mighty. He could do no wrong. But on the inside, he was very weak. He was a man that would fall into sin in the snap of fingers. I mean, he would do the dumbest thing. He was a man that was supposed to be a judge, that was had the body of a man, but had the judgments of a child. I mean, you read the story of Samson, and I mean, this guy would say some of the dumbest thing and get into trouble because even though on the outside he's looking charming, he's doing things, on the inside, he's not letting the light of God burst forth. And this is what we're talking about. This is what we're singing. Lord, from the inside out, I want it to come out. I want a transformation in my life. I want to see it, and I want to maintain that focus in my life. So here's what happened. You know the story. Samson gets flirting with this beautiful girl out of the many he had, you know, named Delilah. And so Delilah is just, you know, it's got it going on. And Samson is just shows up and she makes some breakfast. And Samson is just happy as all get out. Hey, whatever, you know, I'm hungry. He eats and she strokes his hair and he falls asleep. And she, come on, tell me, what is the source of your power? Because this guy was so strong, they couldn't do nothing. So they paid her, hey, tell me, find out what's going on with this guy. So he, you know, he tells him, oh, this is the source of my power. And so they tie him down. Hey, the Philistines are on you. He wakes up, breaks the cord like nothing happened. Oh, come on, Samson, you're not telling me the truth. Sorry, you're not telling me the truth. You don't like me. What's wrong with you? You know, and so, you know, girls can work on a guy when they're going at it, you know. And so, yeah. So she is. She's working it. So she's going at it. No, you got to tell me. Come on, you got to tell me. Oh, is this. Okay, so he falls asleep again. The same process happens over and over. Finally, she hits him right where she said, you don't love me, and I don't want to hang out with you anymore. It's like, no, come on, don't do that. You know. He just like girls. If you see his life, it's just, that's his issue. So he's like, okay, I'm going to tell you. So he tells him, he said, it's my hair. The source of my power is my hair. I'm a Nazarite. I'm supposed to be set apart for the Lord. She puts him to sleep, shaved his head. And when he wakes up, the saddest line, one of the saddest lines for me in the Word of God says, he woke up like every other time yet he didn't realize that God had departed from him. Wow. Think about it. I mean, he had a vision, he had a destiny, he was doing something over and over, and he had focus, but he kept on playing away from his destiny. He kept on dangling and going around away from his vision. And all of a sudden, he said, oh, like every time, God's going to show up. And he doesn't. And he doesn't. And I think that is exactly what God wants for us, to stay focused, not to play and dabble here and go there and dabble this and do that. He wants you to stay focused because he doesn't want you to wake up one day and say, he's going to be with me today. And he's a no-show because you pushed him out. God doesn't want that for us. So in Samson, there is something, how do we recapture this? A lot of people criticize Samson, a lot of people, and rightly so, and everybody preaches this from a negative point of view, and this is why I wanted to ask the Lord, I asked the Holy Spirit, show me a way that's something redeemable here, and boy, did he show me. And Samson, his last day was amazing. He gets trapped, they put him in handcuffs, they walk him in, and the Philistines did something interesting. They poked his eyes out, so he was absolutely blind, and he had no strength whatsoever because his strength was not in his physical appearance. Are you with me? His strength was in the power of God coming upon him. And that is the same for you and I. It is not how much we can show and do and glorify and amen. Just like Pastor Luke was teaching us Sunday night, I'm blessed and highly favored, even though everything is falling apart and we refuse to be honest with ourselves. There's no amen there. That's okay. That's okay. You can save it for later. God wants to do something. And so he is blinded. Finally, let's get to the chapter 16. If you're there with me, what happens is the Philistines are throwing a party to their God. And they're celebrating and getting drunk and partying. Oh, we're celebrating. Our God was more powerful than his God. What an insult. You know, this is why it's important for you and I to stay focused, because the people that know you're Christian, when they see you down, they'll say, hey, what happened to your God? What happened to your God? And it's a tough question. It's a valid question. God's still around. God's still there. Don't mess with God. I believe he's still there, but we're the ones who have to remain focused even in the pressure of people saying, where's your God? Where is he? This is exactly what they were doing. Hey, where's your God? Getting drunk, throwing a big party, and everybody gets into this big coliseum. The Bible says, and we're going to read in a minute, there was 3,000 of them. 3,000 people inside of a coliseum. And so they say, verse 25, Judges 16 says, so it happened when their hearts were merry that they said, call for Samson. So they were all happy, celebrating, drunk, that he may perform for us. So they're going to bring this grown man to put on a show for them. How embarrassing. How embarrassing. How embarrassing. I want you to think about that picture, because this relates to us in many ways. So they call for Samson from the prison, and he performed for them. Wow. You were the conqueror. You were doing great things. You had the house. You had the car. You had the job. You had the looks. And maybe today you're not in the same position that you were before. Maybe not of your own doing. Maybe part of life, part of the economy. But how about if it was out of our own choosing? In the case of Samson, it was out of his own choosing. And I want you to examine yourself today. Don't get depressed, though, okay? We're going to get to a good point. I want you to examine your heart. So they called him Samson from the prison, and he performed for them. And he stayed in between the pillars. They put him there. Now listen, verse 26 says, then Samson said to the lad, a little boy, who held him by the hand. Wow. This picture, when I was reading, it was unbelievable. I mean, it's a full-grown man. This guy was gigantic. He was strong. He did amazing things. And a little kid is guiding him. Do you realize how much limiting that feels? Have you ever felt that way? Have you felt like, man, I feel like I'm walking again like a kid. Like I'm having to go back to my parents' house. I'm having to do things I don't want to do. I'm having to start from the bottom. I'm having to do all these things in life. Samson felt exactly the same way. All these is coming home to roost, and he's saying, man, what is going on in his head? So they're guiding him, and see, let me feel the pillars which support the temple so I can lean on them. I want you to, if you have, you circle that word, lean on them. He was about to focus on something. Verse 27, now the temple was full of men and women. All the lords of the Philistines were there, meaning all the chiefs and bosses and all that. About 3,000 of them. men and women were on the roof watching while Samson performed. Think about that. He is the spectacle of the town when he was the man of power before. That is very, very hard to think about it. Think about that yourself. I mean, if you've ever been in that position where you had something and now you look at yourself and say, man, I'm the joke. I'm the joke. I need God to transform something. And I believe that's what God wants to do tonight. He wants to get you back to the reason why you're supposed to do what you're supposed to do in your life. Don't deviate from that. And if you have, tonight we're going to find out how to get back in line so that we can obtain exactly what you see on the inside of you. When you wake up and you say, this is what I believe God has built me for, I want you to go back to that moment and operate from that moment, because that's what God wants for you. Are you with me tonight? Verse 28 says, and Samson called the Lord saying, this is the verse we're going to focus on today. Call to the Lord saying, O Lord God, remember me, I pray. Strengthen me, I pray, just this once. O God, that I may with one blow take vengeance on the Philistines for my what? I was reading an article about this, and somebody was saying, how selfish is Samson? He's saying, Lord, help me, remember me, that I might take vengeance for my eyes. You know what Samson was saying? God, help me find out why I lost my vision. Help me find out. He was upset. Not that he was in prison. He was upset because he couldn't see it anymore. And that is exactly what I want you to get there tonight. And God wants us to arrive there tonight. He wants us to do three things to recapturing your vision. Recapturing your vision. How do you get there? How do you once again say, you know what? This is what I meant to do. I came to the Lord for this reason. When I came to that, God spoke to me in this direction. I have a business idea. I got to do this with my children. I have to do this with my husband. I have to heal a relationship. I need to make a phone call and say, man, I'm so sorry. 2 months ago this happened. It cannot happen. Happening again. Are you with me? Sometimes God is leading us to recapturing our vision. I remember when I was the first time John Bevere came here a long time ago, and he was teaching about undercover. It was the first message he taught us, but many years ago. And I remember sitting there in the audience, right where you guys are at, and just hearing him preach, and an image came to mind. And I believe God's going to do that for you tonight. He spoke to me about that, and we're going to pray about that at the end. An image. You know what the image was? It was my pastor from the Dominican Republic, from where I'm from. And God spoke to me and said, you got a call, and you have to apologize. And I said, apologize for what? What did I do? He said, because you gave him such a hard time growing up in church. I was like, what? Come on, really? I mean, I was a nice kid. I mean, I turned a few tables here and there, but it wasn't that bad. No, I'm kidding. So I said, okay, Lord. And I remember I called him up on the phone and I said, hey, Pastor Rafael, how you doing? And so we're talking, and then I start explaining to him what I felt. And first he didn't think he needed it, but you know what? A lot of times they don't need it. You need it. You need it. And I need it. And when I said it, it freed me up in so many ways, because he was like a father to me. And God showed me, man, you weren't listening. You weren't listening. You were hard-headed. There was a lot of lessons I could have learned that I didn't, because I was hard-headed. So now I have to go back and mend these things with the help of God to obtain what he has set me for. Are you with me? It's so important that we do that. Recapturing your vision, number one, say it. Say it. With prayer. Say it with prayer. I don't know that a lot of times we understand how powerful prayer is. Prayer is so crucial to the life of the Christian, because prayer is a vital conversation with a pastor, but I feel the words kind of get to the ceiling and bounce back. Then keep praying. Keep pushing through. Don't give up. Don't let up. You have to stay focused. Prayer is a conversation with God. The book of Psalms is just one long prayer. I mean, David would sit down and write and listen to his heart and express, and you and I get encouraged from it. Are you with me? And we'll read a little bit of it, but prayer is that motivating factor in us to say, God, here I am. This is what I want to do. I want to hear what you have to do. I heard, I think it's A.W. Tozer, I don't remember who said it, but he said, any man who is honest with God and with pen and paper will always arrive to the right conclusion. Any man who is honest with God, with pen and paper, will always arrive to the right conclusion. You know what? That's what Psalms did. Here's a man who said, God, here's how I feel today. Oh, Lord, my soul, praise him. I mean, we get encouraged from the psalm. He was letting his soul know, here's where I am, God. I want you to listen to me. I need your direction. Prayer is important, but you have to say it. you have to say, a lot of times we think, well, you know, God can hear my thoughts and he can see my heart, but there's something powerful about when I actually say it. Are you with me? When I actually pray it out loud, something is like, I hear it and then like, oh yeah, that makes sense. Or I hear it and I say, well, what in the world am I praying? You know what I'm saying? When you say it, it transforms you. And I love what it says here. Verse 28 says, then Samson called to the Lord saying, now that expression, he called to the Lord saying, it wasn't a prayer. It wasn't like a simple prayer. It wasn't like what I call like Taco Tuesday prayer. And the prayer goes like this, Lord, thank you for this food. Thank you for this taco. Father, even though I ate tacos yesterday, today they're cheaper, but I thank you today. You know, it's like, we just do this thing, you know, Taco Tuesday prayer. I said it yesterday, but today, you know, it kind of, don't do that. See, Samson, I'm in a pickle, so I'm going to call to the Lord saying, oh, Lord, remember me. He was being expressive. He was letting know. Calling upon the Lord equals a powerful prayer, equals a prayer that's intense. Are you with me? A prayer that you're just letting God know, I'm with you, God, and I need you to listen to me. I went to pray for a friend at the hospital a while back. And this is, I don't know if you remember, a Sunday night, Pastor Jim taught us how to cry out to the Lord. And we were all here crying out to God. And the following Monday, that Sunday, on Monday, I went to visit this particular friend at the hospital. And so we prayed with them. And on the way back home, I'm by myself. It's about 10:30 at night. And I'm driving down the 10 free. And I just feel an urge to pray. I want to pray for this person because there's no way that she's going to die. There's no way that's going to happen to her. And I just said, you know what? Pastor Jim taught us to cry out. So I'm just yelling in my car, Lord, I'm there. And at one moment, I realized, I don't have tinted window on the front. And I just went like, what in the world? These people are going to think I went crazy. But, you know, I said, I don't care. I'm going to go for it. Because I needed God to hear me while I was in the moment. God, I'm going to call out to you. And there's moments like that for us. There's moments where you say, forget who's watching. This is a moment I need to cry. I need God to know I'm into this and I need him to answer. Are you with me? And so it's very important for us to do that. Samson did that. There's another man that you and I know named Jonah. And Jonah did that from a point of humbling. When you're humble, listen to this, listen. When you're humble, you can't be nice about it. When you're in a tough position, you can't be diplomatic about it. Sometimes you just have to go for it. Go for it in prayer. Go for it. And I'm very conservative a lot of times, even though I speak, you know, publicly. But for the most part, I'm kind of conservative. And so my wife, when we pray, sometimes she's a little more intense, and she cries and all this stuff. I'm all philosophical. But sometimes you got to put that aside and just say, Lord, here it is, and I need you to hear it because I need an answer. And so you just lay it out. And Jonah did that. Jonah found himself because he lost his vision. Jonah was asked, hey, man, I need you to go preach to this town. He said, I don't want to preach to San Bernardino. I want them to go to hell. That's what he said in other words, you know. But thank God we're here. We've changed that. He said, go to Nineveh and tell them, no, they're a bunch of sinners. Forget them. I want them to burn. That's what he was saying. And God said, come on, you go. He said, no. So you know the story. He went the opposite way, got on a boat, went to the other side of the planet to get away from Nineveh. Over there, you know, things happened in the boat. A storm came. Finally, he fesses up, hey, man, I'm the one. And they throw him out to the water. Go for it. And says a big fish, it's not a whale, big fish, swallow him. And so there he is in Jonah chapter 2. He starts saying this. And it was so, I'm going to read out of the New Living Translation. I want you to hear this. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from inside the fish. I can guarantee you he wasn't whispering in there. I can guarantee you he was trying to be heard by anybody. Somebody got to hear me out. Are you with me? Verse 2 says, then he said, I cried out to the Lord in my great trouble, and he ignored me. He what? Ah. A lot of times we don't put the passion in it because there's always that sinking feeling. If I put it all out there, and am I going to get a return? If I really trust all the way, is the trust going to be reciprocated? That's what happens in our tithings. That's what happens in our belief for healing. That's what happens in marriage. When I love somebody, if I put out my heart out there, is somebody going to crush it or am I going to get it back? And Jonah said, I cried out to my Lord and he answered me. And he answered me. And he answered me. It might not be the answer you're looking for, but it's the answer you need. It's the answer you need. It's the answer you need. And it's so important for us to understand that. So you're saying, say, I call to you from the land of the dead and the Lord, and you heard me. I mean, he's saying, I'm in the deep, I'm in trouble, yet God is paying attention to me. Verse number 3 says the following. You threw me into the ocean's depths. So he's saying, God, you put me in a tough situation. I sank down to the heart of the sea. The mighty waters engulfed me. I was buried beneath your, says your wild and stormy waves. So he's describing the situation saying, it's bad down here. It's bad where I'm in life right now. I'm frustrated. I can't get it. Verse number 4, then I said, once again, Jonah said, I'm expressing. This is say, then I thought. No. Then I said. Then I said, oh Lord, you have driven me from your presence. He felt, God, I'm away from where I need to be. And this is so important. Why we say, be in church, be connected to people, be working. When you're closer to that, there's going to be answers in your life. And he's saying, I'm away from your presence. Look at this. Yet I will look once more towards your holy temple. So many people forget this. Once they feel the presence of God is not there, they give up, they fold, they walk away. And Jonah said, I'm not walking away. I know I'm here. I know I feel you put me here, Lord. I know I don't feel presence, but still I'm going to ask you and I'm going to look to your temple. I'm going to go to you. I'm going to say it. I'm going to continue going at it. That's the way you capture your vision once again. Verse 7 right there in Jonah says, verse 7, as my life was slipping away. This guy's about to die and he feels it. As my life was slipping away, he's feeling, I'm done. How many people feel here, I'm done. My marriage is done. My health is done. I feel done, Pastor. I feel done. Jonah said, as my life was slipping away, I remember the Lord, and my earnest prayer went out to you, to your holy temple. My earnest prayer. God, look at me. Come on, help me out. Get involved. Refocus me. I need you here. I need your presence once again. But his earnest prayer, God, you have to say it through prayer. God is inviting us to pray. Psalm 50 says it this way. Psalm 50, if you put it up, says, call upon me. This is God telling you and I, call upon me in the day of what? Trouble, and I will deliver you, and you shall what? Glorify me. And that's why we have to say, hey, God has done this for me. God has done good for me. I woke up this morning, man. I'm breathing this morning. I have a job today. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for provision, because I call upon you and you did something in me. So important. Number 2, recapturing your vision. Number 2, recapturing your vision. Plan it. Plan it with passion. Plan it with passion. You have passion to get done what God is putting you. It's not going to happen with simplicity. And this is a message that I believe God is driving me and driving all of us. It needs passion. A friend and I, we're having a conversation with another friend. I just want to keep it kind of that level, but I don't want to mention names. So we're having this conversation with this person, and my friend, he's expressing his, hey, I'm going through this, and it's what's going on. And my other friend said, you know why you're there? He said, because you're not angry yet. Now, we're not talking anger issues. We're not talking, you know, court-mandated anger classes. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a righteous anger about what the devil, where the devil has brought you and put you in. See, many of us are just too easy on the devil and too hard on our friends. Man. Let me say a nicer verse. Maybe we'll smile. Isn't that the truth? I think we all do that sometimes. Not just you. I do that. We just forget that really the Bible says that we're battling against the enemy, not flesh and blood, not the neighbor, not none of that. Even though those are tough situations, hey, bring them to God. But you have to plan. You have to be angry about it. You have to anger yourself in righteous anger about the situation. You have to say, you know what? That's not going to happen in my house anymore. That's not going to happen in my marriage anymore. That's not going to happen at my work anymore. I am making the difference. I'm putting out an effort to focus, because when you plan it with passion, unless you get angry about your situation, absolutely nothing changes. Nothing changes. Look what happened. Judges 16:28, look what happened. It says, he says, oh Lord God, remember me. I pray, strengthen me, I pray just this once. Look at this. Oh God, that I may with one what? One blow take vengeance on the Philistines for my two eyes. He's saying, Lord, I am so angry. I just one time, just let me have it. I'm going to hit them so hard it's going to get done. Just that one time. That's all I need. And I think you have to say that about your situation. Just, Lord, just give me one shot. One shot and we'll get it done, God. That's how focused I'm going to be. That's how I'm going to be involved in the situation. That's how focused. If you give me one shot, I'm going to get it done. Samson, Lord, I know I messed up. I know I sinned. He wasn't defending his sin. Lord, I know I shouldn't have done that. I know I broke my covenant with you. But if you give me one chance, this one time, I'm going to get it done. And I'm going to take vengeance over what happened with my vision, with my focus, with what was my calling, what the calling in our lives is. Are you with me today? And so you need to do that. I feel like you need to get angry about your situation. This is not going to happen anymore. I'm going to make a change. Jesus in the temple, and this is a famous scripture. You guys know a famous situation. Jesus is there. And so he comes and Matthew 21, if you want to look at it. But I love how it says in the book of John, before we go to Matthew 21, in the book of John, it says that Jesus created a whip. He braided a whip. See, Jesus took time. Here's Jesus. Here's how I imagine. He's sitting there right outside of the temple, seeing everybody selling doves and goats and abusing people and stealing over there. And he takes his time, says a couple of straps of leather, starts falling on. I see what's going on there. Oh, check it out. Jesus didn't have no belt. You know, he just didn't pull it out and start whacking like grandpa, you know. That's not how it went down. I mean, he was sat there, said he braided a whip. He took this time. Said, man, I'm nice. Pretty dangerous braid. You know, we're working on it. We're working on it. And I love how John says it because he made a whip. He took his time because he was building a righteous anger in himself, watching what's going on. And look what happens. Matthew 21, verse 12 to 14 says, then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. So he was saying, this is not what's going on here. I'm not going to let it happen. Verse 13. Then he said, it is written. You know what Jesus is saying? There's a vision for this place and this is not it. And there's a vision in your life and you are not in it right now. And unless you get angry and braid a whip in your own life and say, we're going to get it done and restate the vision in your own life, it's not going to get done. It's not going to get done. And we need that. Then he said, it is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. Verse 14, this is why restating the vision and recapturing is important. Then the blind and the lame came in to him in the temple, and he what? While the vision was out of focus, nobody was getting healed. People were getting robbed at church. That's what's going on. People were having little stores out there. Hey, man, this is, you know, your dove is about to fall over the head and one eye hanging. Hey, that's a $2. No, man, it's $20. There's no other one like. I mean, that was what's going on. It's for our God. Are you kidding me? Jesus, this is crazy. This cannot happen. But he didn't sit there and just did a pretty prayer. Father, take care of it, my Lord. He said, not only am I going to pray, I'm going to put my hands to this. Literally, I'm going to put my hands to this, you know. And he braided a whip and took care of it. And sometimes we have to get angry about our situation. Now, that doesn't mean you go beat up on your spouse or your boss. Because we're in San Bernardino, we have to explain it that way, you know. We have to make sure there's a disclaimer about the situation. Some of the Bible's saying. But he's saying you get angry about it enough to do something about it. You pray it, and then you plan it with that important. James 1, I'm not going to read it tonight, but you know it says, be doers of the word, not just hearers. Because if we do that, we deceive ourselves. All we're saying is, oh yeah, I went to church, it was awesome. And then do nothing about it. And God is saying, don't do that. If you hear it, then find a way to implement it. Are you with me? Find a way to put it into action. Very, very important that we do that. Very important. We're talking about recapturing our vision. Recapturing your vision, number one. Number one, we talked about it today, which is say it with prayer. Number two, you plan it with passion. And number three, and very important, do it. You take action. Can you do that with me? One, two, three. Do it. Take action. You have to do that. As a matter of fact, reminding me of his story, let me read it to you because I could say it, but I want to read it. Several years ago, I heard the story of Larry Walters, a 33-year-old man who decided he wanted to see his neighborhood from another perspective. He went down to the local surplus store that morning and bought 45 used weather balloons. Weather balloons are a little bigger and beefier than regular balloons. That afternoon, he strapped himself to a lawn chair, and with several of his buddies, they filled up the balloons with helium. So he sat in the chair, put a six-pack of beer, a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, and a BB gun. And he figured, hey, while I'm up there to come down, I'll just shoot one balloon at a time, and it'll let me down easy. Walters, who assumed the balloons would lift him maybe 100 feet in the air, was caught off guard when his chair soared to 11,000 feet in the air and put him right in the middle of air traffic at LAX. Too frightened to shoot any balloons, they had to shut the airport down. The runways were shut down, causing delays for many flights across the country. Soon enough, they brought him down, the police arrested him, and they asked him three questions. Were you scared? Yes. Why would you do it again? No. Why did you do it? Because a man just can't sit around. It's so interesting. Some of us need to take action, but we need to think about the action a little. This guy just went crazy. It is so true what he's saying. He just took action upon, hey, I want to see life from a different perspective. I want to get a different view of my neighborhood, so I'm going to do something about it. And many of us, it takes that. It takes some action, guys. And, you know, when we preach the word here, and we're a preaching, Bible-believing church, and we're continuing that, sometimes we feed ourselves so much, and now we have to put it into action in many ways of our life. We have to challenge that word that's on the inside of us. Are you with me? We have to put it to the test. We have to put it out there in our own life. So tonight we're going to talk about liberal action and pray for it. But God is leading us to say, hey, don't just think about it and pray about it and do something pretty about it and you're upset and wound up, but then no action is taken. And look what happens here. Judges 16, 29 and 30 says, and Samson took a hold of the two pillars. So he prays, said, God, let me do this. Give me one more time the strength to do this. And Samson took a hold of the two middle pillars which supported the temple, and he braced himself against them, one on his right hand and the other on his left. I mean, this guy's making sure, I'm gonna get it done. I'm putting, now listen, he knew he was weak. Do you understand? Nothing has changed. He doesn't know that God is with him yet. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say that he feels power. He just said, Lord, I messed up, but I'm asking you to help me, and I'm going to take action. So he said, you know what? I'm going to grab this puppy over here. I'm going to grab it, and I'm going to pull. See what happens. And the, Pastor Jim has expression for us. If we do the natural, God does the what? A super. The super. And that's verse 30 says, then Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. And he pushed with all his might. He just said, you know what? Let it so. Let it be. I'm going to get it done. And it's so important that Samson took. Many people said he was selfish in his prayer. But look at this prayer. He said, even if I die, I'm going to accomplish the purpose for what I was born for. Even if it costs something in my life, I'm going to go ahead and take a risk in what I need to do for God. And I believe God is challenging some of us to do that, to take out a step and do that. I'm so proud of my wife. She's so bold. She's very quiet. I mean, very timid and petite, but she's so bold. We have some neighbors, and she told me one day, it was like 9:30 at night, we put the kids to bed, and she said, I'm going to go preach to those neighbors. I said, woman, are you crazy? It's 9:30. I mean, they're going to hate us. What are you talking about? So see here? Now listen, the pastor is telling somebody not to preach. There's a problem right there. I've repented since and have preached since. But so we're talking about it. And I said, no, it's 9:30. You know, you're doing all the logical steps. What are you talking about? But she said, no, I believe God is asking me to do it. And she went over. Sure enough, man, she knocked. She told them, hey, you guys need to do this, this, and that. And she came back. Nothing happened. They didn't give their hearts to the Lord. But she said something that's so important. She said, I obey God, and at least they know that somebody told them about God. They can't hide away from that fact. And many times, many times that's all God wants. God wants your action, and he'll back it up somewhere or the other. He'll show up to do that, but it takes that action. Samson, you know what? I've already prayed. Now, this is my plan. My plan is I'm going to pull this puppy over here and this here. And I'm just going to go for it. That's my action. And when he did, God responded. It said that the temple fell on the Lord's, meaning all the bosses are there, and all the people who were in it. So listen to this. So the dead he killed on his death were more than he had killed in his life. Wow. I mean, what he accomplished the day he died was far greater than everything he did in his 20 years ruling Israel. And I believe some of us are in that position today. We're saying, God, it's now or never. Is that serious? Is now or never? I make a change now, or it's not going to happen. I make a change now. I take action this moment, or I'm going to maintain in that same routine. And God doesn't want that for you, but it's going to take faith. It's going to take that you take action. Actually, Hebrews 11 mentions him. A lot of people, oh, he was a sinner. He was this. He was that. Yes, he was all that. But I believe that prayer brought repentance to his heart. And look, he's mentioned in the Hall of Fame of faith believers. The Bible is an interesting place. There's a prostitute in the line of Jesus, and there's a sinner in the Hall of Fame of faith. This is why the Bible says God is not a respecter person. God is not a respecter person. He's just looking for you to say it, make a plan, and get going, and I'm going to back you up. I'm going to be right there with you. We're going to get that view that we've been looking for in our hearts. Hebrews 11 says the following, if you put it up there for me. Let me see if I have it here. Hebrews 11 says, verse 32, and what more shall I say? What more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophet. Look, verse 33 says, who through faith, through what?
Faith.
Through what?
Faith.
Make a note, through faith, not just your own action, not your own power, but you have to do action believing God's going to do something. Through faith, subdued kingdoms and work righteousness, obtain promises, stop the mouth of lions, quench the violence fire, escape at the edge of a sword, says, out of weakness were made what? Strong. Out of weakness. Man, I can't do this, God. I keep struggling. I keep falling in the same spot. I keep making the same mistake. I keep finding the same type of people. But he said they became valiant in battle. It doesn't say they became valiant in the couch or valiant watching others do stuff. It said when they brought the fight, they stepped up. When the fight came to them, they were ready to go. And it's so important that we do that. I mean, God is calling us, you know, to girl fight. And this is why it's different. Guys, they want to look cool even when there's a mess. You know, just girls, man, if I grow a clump of hair, it's going. Let's go. You know, we're just going to go for it. And so sometimes, spiritually speaking, it's kind of like that. It's kind of like, I'm just going to go for it, Lord. I'm just going to get going. I'm just going to get into action. I'm going to do something. I'm going to get active. I'm going to get focused. God wants that for us. I'm going to end with this verse, Romans 5, because it's such an important verse, because you need faith in your life, but this is how you're going to get it. You're going to get it through the grace of God. You need his strength. Samson didn't do it on his own. He says, through whom also, talking about Jesus, Romans 5:2, through whom also we have access by faith into what? Oh, wait. We have access. Okay, here's a door. That's faith. And on the other side, there's God's sovereign, divine ability to do the job on my behalf when I can't do it. It's so important for us to see that. Romans is saying, it's when you believe and you step through that door, it's through that door that you'll find grace on the other side waiting for you. I've been waiting all along here. If you took the action, we're going to get it done together. God's power on your behalf was going to take some action with you. And it says, for what? Into grace in which we what? We stand. You'll be strong, focused, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And hope that that radiance is going to come through, and hope that he'll be here. 2 Corinthians says that we thanks be to God who always causes us to what? to win, to triumph. He always does. And that's what God wants for you tonight and for me. Three things that I want you to get focused, and I'll end with this. Three things: recapturing your vision, recapturing the place you're supposed to be in your life and the place God wants you to be in. Do three things. You have to say it with prayer. You have to plan it with passion. You have to do it and take action. If God spoke to you tonight, give him a hand. We pray tonight and end tonight, I want to make sure that your heart is with God. See, we can talk about this. We can say, hey, say it, pray it, amen, vision it, that's going to be awesome. But if you don't have Jesus in your heart, all this is just a good positive word for you. You need to have a commitment in your heart before everything. And this is the question I want you to ask yourself before we go any further, before we end tonight, before we pray for a vision in our hearts. If you were to die, this moment ends, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Most people, I was reading in a magazine, especially in the Hispanic culture, we're very God-focused. Our grandparents and parents, they teach us about God. They teach us respect and the prayer and all that. There's a certain understanding. And so people say, Pastor, of course I'm going to heaven. I mean, my grandma taught me, my mom told me. I mean, there's an understanding of it. I know who God is. I know who Jesus is. But no one in the Bible says it just because of knowing, like I have a concept in my head, an understanding about Jesus, that makes me a Christian or leads me to heaven. It doesn't say it. It's simply not that simple. Some people say, Pastor, I'm a little better than that. I mean, not only do I know about Jesus, I know because I've been to a church. And, you know, when I was little, I took catechism class. I learned verses. You know, Satan, the devil, he knows verses. He quotes them to Jesus when he tempts in the temptation. And he is certainly not going to heaven. The Bible says that demons believe and they tremble, but they're not going to heaven. See, it's not a matter of my information, it's a matter of what's in my heart. When God looks at me, he's looking at the condition of my heart. And that's what he wants you to look at your heart and say, if you can honestly say here tonight, Pastor, yes, I'm going to heaven, then I want you to make sure. How do you make sure? Pastor, I'm a great person. I mean, I've been to a church. I've been part of a great church. So was I. My mother took me to church since I was little. And I remember sitting in a church, way smaller than this, in the back, 12 years old. Some preacher was preaching. It was a small church. There was no youth group. And I was sitting with the adults. And I remember thinking in my heart when he asked to pray if I wanted to ask Jesus in my heart, I raised my hand right away. And I just knew that even though I went to church, even though I won titles in children's ministry about knowing all the books of the Bible, and I'm a great student of the Bible, I knew in my heart at 12 years old, I'm not right with God, even though I've been in church every Sunday. See, because it's not a matter of the things you do. Remember, Samson was exteriorly amazing, but internally problematic. And that's where the source is. It's in your heart. Here's what God wants you to do. In a moment, I'm going to ask you that you raise your hand if you need Jesus today. If you haven't made Jesus your Lord and Savior, you have to do that. Because Jesus, having a conversation with a man named Nicodemus, he said, hey, Nicodemus, you're great. Because Nicodemus was great. The Bible says he was a leader in his church, in the synagogue. He was a leader of the Jew, which means he was a man of position. He was a man of importance. He was a man that knew the laws of the Bible. He had to know the Old Testament. He was a brilliant man about what God was about. Yet Jesus told him, Nicodemus, you must be, listen to this, be born again. The term born again, people make fun of it, and people say, oh, born again, they're weird, and they raise their hands. Those people are weird. Yet that is exactly what God demanded. Born again has nothing to do whether you're weird or not. The movies make it weird. But that's not a reality. It's the condition of your heart. See, Jesus says, listen, his words. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. There is no other way to connect with God than through Jesus. He says, when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you, listen to this term, lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Graphic words written here. You know why? Because God doesn't want you to play with him. This is what he's saying. Hey, you're either in or you're out. In the middle doesn't work. A little bit here, a prayer from time to time. Pastor, I went to a church a year ago. I'm back. Hey, man, this is awesome. No games. He said, you got to be focused. Remember we talked about regaining our vision? That's what God wants. You have to regain it. And that means that you have to pick a side. You have to say, I'm going to be with God all in, because he went all in for you. He didn't send half of his son. He sent his son to die fully for you, because he has a plan for your life. But it starts with you giving him an opportunity in your own heart. In a moment, I'm going to count to three. And when I count to three, I'll hit my Bible. And when I do, when you hear that, you raise your hand right where you're at. And together, we'll pray tonight, inviting Jesus in your heart. Pastor, why do I have to raise my hand? A quiet prayer would be great. Remember what we talked about today? That there's got to be action. I don't know why God wants it that way, but he does. Every time Jesus demanded salvation, or Jesus present the salvation to people, he made it publicly, and he wants you to make a decision. And the book of Luke says, if you acknowledge me before men, I will acknowledge you before my Father. But if you deny me, if you say it's not for me, he says, I will deny you. He loves you, but he doesn't want you to play games with him. He wants you to make a decision. And tonight is that night for you to make a decision. Who should raise your hand when I count to three? If you're not sure, make sure. Who should raise your hand? If you're thinking in your heart, well, maybe, then just say it. This is my night. If you know God spoke to you tonight and you're not right, if it was today your last day, you're not right with God, then do it. Tonight, just say, you know what, God? I'm going to make it right. Tonight is my night. I'll count to three. You raise your hand. We'll pray together, inviting Jesus in your heart. Don't let anything distract you. Don't let the devil convince you, I shouldn't do that. Well, just do that. Be brave. Take action. God will meet you on the other side. One, two, and three. This is your moment. This is your time. Is there anybody here? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. There's three, four. Thank you so much. You can lower your hand. Thank you so much. Anybody? Five. Thank you. Six, seven, eight. How awesome. Awesome. Is there 9, 10? There's a hand. All right, I see you. I see two more. 10. Thank you so much. You can lower your hand. Thank you. Is there anyone else here? Is there anyone else that you're saying, oh, I want, do it. Don't let the devil convince you otherwise. Look at the tray. He's saying, hey, if you don't raise your hand, you might not look or feel it, but if you die, you go to hell. That's a tray you don't want to do. God is asking you tonight, I got to make sure. I want to make sure before I walk out. I need to recapture my commitment with God. This is your moment. Is there anyone else tonight other than those 10 hands I saw? This is your moment. Thank you so much. 11, 12, thank you. Anyone else? 13, 14, 15. We want to give you a chance. We're ready for this. This is your moment. Is there anyone else? Last time. Thank you. 13. Oh, awesome. All right, would you give God a hand for this 13 lives? God is so good. God is so good. In a moment, this is what we're going to do. In a moment, everyone is going to stand. And when everyone stands, if you raise your hand, I'm going to ask you to take one more step of action and boldness. I want to personally pray with you and invite Jesus in your heart. Take whatever you have in your chair, your purse, your Bible, a book. Don't leave anything in your chair. You meet me right here, and we'll pray together, inviting Jesus in your heart. Take that moment of action. Let's all stand and welcome them tonight as they come to ask Jesus in their heart. Thank you, Lord. Come on, let's welcome them tonight.
I give you
take the step.
Heart.
Take the action. God will meet you right where you're at. Thank you. This is your moment. Don't stay behind. Don't stay behind. Bring your children with you. Thank you, God. Thank you so much. Just make that decision. If you didn't raise your hand, but you wanted to and you should have, just meet me right here. We'll invite Jesus right now. Just meet me right here. Just say, this is my moment. I'm not letting it go. This is my moment. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Come on, can we praise Jesus for them? Thank you, guys. What a moment of bravery. Awesome. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much. Hey, if you're here, if you're up front, you guys are so brave. You put a smile on your face. This is going to be awesome. All you're saying is, God, I acknowledge I have a need of you. And we're saying as a church, we're going to be on your side. As a matter of fact, we are all those people here. They're brothers and sisters. They're behind you. They're going to have your back in prayer. But first, let's invite Jesus into our heart. Everybody, can we pray with them? Is that okay? Invite Jesus. Come on, make your way. There's one more. Take your time. Come up front. Amen. He listens. What we're going to do. You're going to repeat a prayer with me. Come on. you're going to repeat a prayer with me. And that prayer is not a magical word. It's simply, the Bible says that if you say it with your mouth and believe it in your heart, remember we talked about God sees your heart, that moment something happens and changes in your life. And everybody here, we want to pray with you. So repeat after me and say, Dear Jesus, I invite you to my heart and I ask you to forgive me of my sins, the wrongdoings I've committed against you. Today, I believe in you. I believe in your son. I believe I'm forgiven. I believe I'm heading to heaven and not to hell. From this day forward, I'll see you in eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Awesome. This is what we want to do. As you pray with us, that's my friend Pastor Joel, and he's my real friend. But we have lunch together from time to time. He pays, that's why we have lunch. But no, I'm kidding. But he's a great guy. Here's what we're going to do. He's going to go with you, and he's going to offer you a few things. He's going to offer you a friend. You need a friend, somebody who would help you get strong in church, focus you. That's called an SPT, a spiritual personal trainer. Here's the second thing he'll do. He's going to also pray even more with you. If you need prayer, if you need encouragement, he's going to direct you. We want you to do something, something we say at The Rock. Give us 1 year. 1 year coming to church, committed, saying, you know what? Today was just not a fluke. I'm going to take it serious. If you do that for 1 year, your life will be absolutely transformed. We believe that. Every one of those people said, I'm making that commitment. Their lives are transformed. Let us do that. Follow Pastor Joel over there. He'll get you that information, and you can go home. Thank you, guys. Come on, encourage them. You guys are awesome. Go ahead. You can take your children if you want. They'll be okay.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to The Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.